Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
I want to look at several things as it relates to this and make some spiritual applications this morning. Number one, in verse 13, we see the familiar path, the fashionable path, the frequented path. And it says, "Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat." It is the broad way that many people take. They look at the familiar path, the most frequented path, and they say, well, it looks like everyone's going that way, so that's the way I'm going to go. But it turns out that it's a highway to hell. Long before any rock group ever decided to write a song about it. But it's not going to be anything to sing about when you end up there. It's a detour to doom. Proverbs 14:12 said, "There is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death." Proverbs 21 and verse 2 said, "Every way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord pondereth the heart." Everybody thinks they know the way, or they assume that God will put a stamp of approval on their way because it seems good, it's familiar, it's fashionable, it seems like everyone is comfortable with that. And since so many people are doing it, must be right. Wrong. Jeremiah 17 and verse 10 said, "I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings." Some people will say, "I just want what's coming to me." Don't worry. You'll get it. And so in verse 13, we see, as I said, the familiar, the fashionable, the frequented. Most people, according to that verse, are very comfortable in that. But as we have read and as we'll see, it's not the right way. So don't get too comfortable. Then we see in verse 14, we see the few. Not the proud, not the Marines, but the we see the few. Notice it says there, "Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." I know that this really strikes an unresponsive chord to many, but God doesn't give a flying flip how many people are going the broad way. He doesn't care how frequent people go that way. He doesn't care how fashionable it is. He doesn't care what you think. The way that God wants people to go, only a few people will go that way. In other words, Jesus Christ said, if we take these two verses here and just, I'm not even going to say read in between the lines, but say what it says. Most people are going to die and go to hell. Well, I don't believe. Take it up with Jesus. Most people are going to die and go to hell, and only a few people are going to be saved. That's what it's saying. Now, you can disagree all you want, but if you disagree, then you're going to be part of that crowd that's going the broad way. And you'll find out one day that it was the wrong way. Jesus said in John 14 in verse 1 to 6, he said, "Let not your heart be troubled." He said, "You believe in God? You believe also in me." He said, "In my Father's house are many mansions." He said, "If it were not so, I would have told you." He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. He said, and whither I go, he said, you know, and the way you know. And right away, they thought to themselves, no, we don't. And maybe you're sitting there thinking the same thing. I don't know. And Thomas, we all know old doubting Thomas. Is that you this morning? He said, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And he didn't put a period there. He said, no man cometh unto the Father but by me. So you want to climb up some other way? Jesus said in John chapter 10, you're a robber and you're a thief. You think you're going to climb, come through the back door to heaven? Sneak in through a window? No. You must come by way of the door. Jesus said, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall go in and out and find pasture. Acts 4:12 says, neither is there salvation in any other. I was kind of hoping for another way. There is no other way. He said, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Individuals heard Jesus talk like this, and in Luke 13 and verse 23 and 24, one of them said to him, Lord, are there few that be saved? And he said unto them, strive to enter in at the straight gate. He didn't come right out and answer the question, but he told him the way to go. We see, I don't know, I look at it like this. Jude said, some, he said, save with compassion, making a difference. Some people are motivated by that. He said, but others save with fear, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. And so some people are going to need to have their tree shaken. Probably ought to have their neck throttled. But shaking the tree, somebody wrote a song about all shook up. Because normally what happens, people will do something when they get all shook up. But until they're shaken, I think of places in the Bible where, like the Philippian jailer, once that place got all shook up and he got all shook up, that's when he said, what must I do to be saved? But until he got shook up, he was more than content to beat up and lock up and probably poke fun of Paul and Silas till he got shook up. I fear that some of you will just sit here and listen year after year after year, and nothing will shake you. And it won't be because someone didn't try. But you'll die and go to hell. You mark her down. I don't know everything there is to know about this book. But as far as salvation is concerned, I know what this book says real well. Real well. And if you think you're going to be the exception, you're not. And that's why we have this passage here. Jesus Christ is just as plain as the nose on your face. He said, don't go the way that you see everybody else going. It's not the right way. He said, it's a narrow way. It's a way that most people wouldn't even consider, like a free gift, like a free gift. And so we see here, and Jesus goes on, because after he gives this instruction, it's immediately followed by verse 15, where he says, beware of false prophets. He immediately warns, see, because he just told you the truth. And they said, yeah, but you better watch out because there's going to be people who are going to come around and they'll try to tell you, yeah, but what about this? And how about that? He says in verse 15, beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing. In other words, they're not going to look as though they're your enemy, that they're out to get you. They're real friendly. But inwardly, they are ravening wolves. John wrote in 1 John 4, in verse 1 and 2, he said, beloved, believe not every spirit. He said, but try the spirits, whether they be of God. Because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And so you can detect a false prophet, a false religion, immediately if they don't believe that Jesus Christ is God. Dismiss them immediately. Don't listen to another word they have to say. Because according to John, that's not of God. He says in Luke 20, in verse 46 and 47, beware of scribes which desire to walk in long robes and love the greetings in the markets and have television programs and smile a lot and the highest seats in the synagogues and chief rooms at feasts, which devour widows' houses and for a show make long prayers. He said, the same shall receive greater damnation. He said, watch out for that religious crowd. They're trying to protect themselves. They're trying to put on a show. They want you to love and appreciate them. See, salvation really doesn't have that much to do with me or a church. It has to do with him. It's all about him. And so anyone comes sporting about how wonderful they are, I'm so tired of watching, you know, I'm a big nobody. But it kind of pains me when I see people all involved with, they got to chase around this guy and that guy. And listen to waste time, but they're madly in love with man. How wonderful they are. Well, I'll just tell you right up front. I've never been anybody. I'm never going to be anybody. And if God allows me to do anything, then he gets the credit for it. That's it. 2 Peter 2 in verse 1 to 3. But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you. Really? Yeah, really. I know it's hard to believe. Who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. In other words, they say, oh, it's not just him. It's not just a free gift. It's not what he did on the cross. People follow that. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise of you. Send away right now. We have these blessed handkerchiefs. Yep. What they do is they minimize sin. This is what you have to watch out for. Because Jesus Christ came into the world to save. Ready? I'm going to do a Joe Biden. Sinners. Really? Yeah. He didn't come to show bad men how to be good or good men how to be better. He didn't come to start a religion. He's not a victim of circumstance. He came specifically to die for you and for me. And so anyone that would come along and minimize sin, like, Larry, See, God has given me the ministry of encouragement. I would turn that off in a heartbeat. Nothing that they do, not only do they minimize sin, they humanize God. And they deify man. And they teach self-atonement. And they delay repentance. And they avoid at all costs preaching against hell. You know, I don't know if you ever picked up on this or not, Jesus spoke more of hell then he spoke of heaven. And so we're told the way that most people are going. And then we're told what the right way to go is. And then we're warned, watch out for those fake ones that are going to come and tell you something different. Present another gospel. Look at verse 20. He says, wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. Now, there's a big controversy in Christendom over this subject right here. And some would have it to say that you are, if you have an expectation of good to come afterwards, and if that doesn't exist, then they're not really saved. But that's not true. You don't have to do good, live right, have something to show to prove that you're saved. Salvation has nothing to do with our works. Salvation has to do with us trusting Christ as our Savior. That's what it has to do with. Now, he begins to do a work in us afterwards. But the point I'm making is God and everyone else is looking for and expecting some fruit to come out of your salvation. Again, I'm not saying that if it's not, I'll give you an example. If we were to go, depending upon the time of year, and go into an orchard and look at the trees in there, could we or would we see an apple tree that has no fruit on it? Yeah, most likely. Does that mean it's not an apple tree? No. It just means it has no fruit on it. Jesus had a problem with a fig tree one time. And it wasn't that it wasn't a fig tree, because it was. But he just expected that there would be fruit on it. And there wasn't. And so he wanted it to be fertilized and to allow it to stay for a while. See, God's working on us, folks. And there will be and there ought to be some good that comes from the life of a saved person. But rather than say, well, because you still do this or go here or say that means you're not saved, that's not true. And so I want to make that point. God does expect. Matter of fact, even Paul said in Philippians 4 and verse 17, he said, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. There's nothing wrong with producing fruit. Matter of fact, if we're a fruit tree, then we ought to produce fruit. When you become a new creature in Christ, then Jesus Christ desires a life that is going to abound with good. I mean, after all, we are saved unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. So God wants to see good. God wants to see fruit out of saved people. But if you don't have any, just like in the world, we have some good children and we have some rotten children. I know you don't, but they do exist. There are some rotten kids. and they're going to live their whole life rotten. But it doesn't mean that they're not your kids. I go to the jail and there's some rotting people there. And their parents, no doubt, at one time had high hopes. That is so. But guess what? They didn't live up to that. Does that make them not their children? No, just makes them a child that's rotten. In Galatians 5, in verse 19 to 23, the Bible said, "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these." He said, "Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of which," he said, "I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." That's a whole other story there. He didn't say that you couldn't enter or see. He said you're not going to inherit it, which is a different thing altogether. But then he says, "But the fruit of the Spirit." And in Romans 8 and verse 9, the Bible said, "If any man hath not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his." So when you got saved, the Spirit of God moved inside of you. And when he moved inside of you, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Now, if we as the children of God, indwelt by the Spirit of God, are producing what the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit is, then we will demonstrate, we have to, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. But if we're not, if we're living after the flesh, then what the world will see, what God will see, is all the other junk that we read about in verse 19 and thereafterwards. Paul said in Romans 7 and verse 4, "Wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that ye should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that ye should bring forth fruit unto God." So I'm sorry to all those that say that you don't have to bring forth any fruit in order to be saved. Well, not in order to prove that you're saved. But if you're going to be what God wants you to be, you're going to bring forth fruit. And if you don't, you might want to check what's wrong in your life. If you don't have any desire for God, if you don't have any desire for his word, if you don't have any desire to live right and do right, I don't know. What's the problem? You may be a rotten child of God. Is that how you want to live your life? Not how I want to live. I want to please him. Now we see the fallacy. The fallacy is in verse 21 to 23. "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord." You mean like those that say, Hail Mary, full of grace? "Our Father which art in heaven." You mean that kind of stuff? Yeah, that kind of stuff right there. "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord." Notice how this, Lord, Lord. Oh, praise Jesus. "Have we not prophesied in thy name?" Can't you see we're doing spiritual stuff? "And in thy name have cast out devils." Yeah, I'd like to see that. "And in thy name done many wonderful works." And Jesus said, "Oh yeah, I'm sorry, I forgot that you did all that. Welcome." "No. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." I never knew you. What are you talking about? See, the fallacy is that if we put on a religious exterior, if you go to church, if you carry a Bible, if you put a suit and tie on, that's got to mean something. It means absolutely nothing. Jesus said in Luke 6 and verse 46, "Why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say?" James 1:22 said that we're to be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Paul wrote to Titus in Titus 1 and verse 15 and 16, he said, "Unto the pure all things are pure, but unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure. But even their mind and their conscience is defiled. They profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient and unto every good work reprobate." The fallacy is that not everyone that claims or looks religious is. It goes a little deeper than that. It's a little more personal than just putting on a show. But then we see the fix. The fix is in verse 24 to 27. Therefore, whosoever heareth the sayings of mine and doeth them, see, it's all boiling down. He's given the instruction. He's given the warning. Watch out for those people that are going to set you in a different direction. And don't get caught up with the idea that it's just something that you can do. See, Christianity is not something we do. It's something that we are. Do I have to say that again? Because there's a big difference. And Jesus addressed that. But then he said, okay, now here's the fix. What you need, he said, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man. You know, it's very wise to get saved. And only a fool wouldn't. The only thing that would keep someone from getting saved is foolish pride. To somehow think that somehow you can come another way. Well, go all the way back to Cain and Abel, and you'll find out that those two characters found out that God meant business. And you're either going to go God's way or you're not coming. So he says here, I'm going to liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon the house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. See, what you need, son, is a foundation. And the foundation is not a church. It's not a creed. It's not your favorite preacher. The foundation is Jesus Christ. He's the rock. Your salvation is going to be based upon him and him alone. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 3, in verse 11, he said, "For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Christ Jesus. Now, if any man build upon this foundation," see, what people are trying to do is they're trying to build on a foundation that does not exist. By the way, Jesus continued in verse 26 and 27 to that crowd. He said, "And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine," hopefully you're not one of them this morning, "and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds," same catastrophe, "and beat upon that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it." Why? Bottom line, didn't have a foundation. Or the foundation was nothing more than sand. The only thing that's going to hold up in the storms of life is going to be Jesus Christ. And if you're not built on him, don't worry. A storm will come. It may be a financial trouble. It may be a relationship difficulty. It may be you fill in the blank. But mark my word, there will come a day when what you thought was holding you up crumbles. Nahum 1 and verse 7, "The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knoweth them that trust in him." Jesus Christ this morning knows whether or not you're trusting him or you're trusting in yourself. Peter put it like this in 1 Peter 2 in verse 5 to 8. He said, ye also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Wherefore also he is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious. Anyone agree with that this morning? He's precious, all right. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner. And a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them that stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. You see, if you believe that he is your foundation, then that's very precious. But if you don't believe that he is, then you will find him to be a rock of offense rather than a precious support system. So we've seen this morning the familiar, the fashionable, the frequent. Don't follow the crowd, folks. Now we saw the few. We saw the false. They're out there, they're everywhere. And their leader, the devil himself, is a deceiver, and he'll lead you astray. And we see the fruit that ought to be. And again, I'm not going to go and shake your tree. I know this, that I could go around the room right now and shake your tree. And the only thing that would really prove is whether or not you're spiritual, whether or not you have any fruit. But it wouldn't tell me whether you're saved or lost. The only thing I can do with that is take you at your word. If you said, no, I trusted Christ as my Savior. I put my faith and trust in the shed blood of Jesus Christ for the remission of my sin. I'm trusting him and him alone. Now, you could be lying through your teeth, but I'll take you at your word that you're saved. But if you're not producing any fruit, I think you're a rotten kid. And I won't recant that. God expects, the Bible expects, all of Christianity expects, the world expects that you're going to live up to the name that you claim. But I'll leave the determination as to whether or not you're saved up to God. We've seen the fallacy. Some people think, I'll just go to this church. I had someone tell me just recently, maybe I should go back to church. For what? Apparently, the church didn't do anything for you when you were going there before. Going to church means nothing. The fix is get a foundation in your life. And not a religious group, denomination. Don't change Bibles. Get Jesus Christ in your life. We've got the facts. Can I give them to you quickly? Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's a fact. Now you can disagree with it if you want, but it's what God said. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So, salvation's a gift. Revelation 20 and verse 15, whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Is your name written there? Boy, it better be. Jesus said in Luke 19:10, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. He cares about you. John 1:12 said, for as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Have you received him? What are you waiting on? When will you? Romans 10 and verse 9 and 10, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Romans 10, 13, for whosoever, that's you, that's me, shall call upon the name of the Lord, shall be saved. What path are you on this morning? Which way are you going? What have you been told? What are you believing? What are you listening to? What kind of profession, if any, have you made? What evidence are you exhibiting? This isn't in the Bible, but it's important. There was a poet from days gone by the name of Robert Frost. Cool dude. And he wrote a poem, The Road Not Taken. And the last three lines of that poem go like this. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. May the message you've heard today speak to your heart, and remember, God loves you, Christ died for you, and ye must be born again. Thank you for watching.